Hachette Audio presents Balance, a story of faith, family, and life on the line. Written by Nik Wallenda with David Ritz. Read by Steve Gibbons. God is my center. God's grace is the balancing pole that keeps me from falling into self-obsession and self-deception. Whatever I have achieved and will ever achieve is the result of my relationship with Him. This book is a continuation of that relationship. I invoke His Holy Spirit in helping me understand my past. I need His insightful compassion to illuminate my story and the story of my remarkable family. As God inspires me every hour of every day, I pray that the same inspiration informs every page of this book. I pray that the miracle of His limitless love touches me as I write, just as it touches you as you listen. Chapter 1. Dream. The first things I notice are the dogs. They're Karen Terriers, like Toto in The Wizard of Oz. Like the terriers that Mom and Dad keep as pets. The warm and fuzzy pups that are part of my clown act. I'm a kid in this dream. A little boy on a journey whose destination is unknown. I walk through the woods. The sky is clear. The sun, bright. The air, clean. The dogs run ahead of me, leading the way. The woods morph into a jungle. There are chimpanzees and exotic birds perched in the trees. Wildflowers are everywhere. In the distance, I make out the trumpet cry of an elephant. I hear the growl of lions and tigers. I'm not afraid because I've been around all sorts of animals. I'm a circus kid with circus parents from whom I've inherited a circus life. Are the dogs directing me to a circus where I'll put on my clown's outfit and perform? As the dogs charge ahead, I sprint to keep up. The jungle turns into a green meadow, and the meadow leads to a mountain covered with blue and yellow wildflowers. The sounds change. The cry of the beasts transform into the roar of raging water. What is the source? Where is the water? Chasing after the pups, I run up the mountainside. The faster I run, the taller the mountain seems to grow, the louder the roar. I keep running and running, wondering if this is a trick. Is this real? Will I ever reach the top? I finally do. I stop to catch my breath and survey the scene. Spread out before me is a natural wonder, a spectacular horseshoe-shaped waterfall commanding the width of the entire horizon. Walk over the falls. I turn around and see the man who has spoken these words. He is dressed in the billowy white shirt and satin trousers outfit of a circus performer. His face is friendly. His voice is not stern, not frightening, but simply clear. He speaks in a tone that is matter of fact, repeating the words for a second time. Walk over the falls. Although the task seems impossible, the idea excites me. It seems like fun. I want to do it. I want to know how. I want to know where to set the poles and put up the cable. I want the man to instruct me. But just as I turn to him for more instruction, I wake up. Over the years, the dream will assume different forms, but the theme never changes. Not only am I challenged to achieve the impossible, but the challenges grow in dimension. I soon realize that the man who haunts my imagination, awake and sleeping, is Karl Wallenda, the great patriarch of the Wallenda family. He is the man who fell from the high wire to his death in Puerto Rico on March 22, 1978, 10 months before my birth on January 24, 1979. He is the man who entered my dreams early in my life and has remained there ever since. He is also the man who is my mother's grandfather and my father's teacher, the man who literally brought my parents together and hired them to work in his company of performing artists. Amazingly enough, one day the abstract dream becomes concrete reality when my parents are performing at the Shrine Circus in Buffalo. That's when they take their two children to Niagara Falls. I'm 6, and my sister Liana is 8. We spend months at a time on the road, and on days off, we often visit places of interest like the Washington Monument or the field where the Battle of Gettysburg was fought. I like these tourist excursions. I find them fascinating. But Niagara is something else altogether. I'm not only stunned by its tremendous size, but thrilled to be facing an awesome sight that seems to have emerged from my dream. "I've been here before," I tell my dad. "You must have seen pictures, son," he says. "We've never been here before." "I have." Dad laughs off my remarks, but I cling to the memory. As we drive from the America side to Canada for a closer look at the rushing waters cascading some 20 stories down into the Niagara River, I relive my dream. My heart beats like crazy. I don't feel at all crazy. I feel connected. I feel centered. I don't know what to call these feelings. I don't know how to describe the excitement coursing through me. I don't know words like destiny and purpose. My parents have taught us that all good things come from God, so I do know that this sensation of being connected to my dreams has to be good. I know that God has to be at the center of my imagination that is constructing a wire across the falls. In my mind, I see myself walking from one country to another. Even as a child, I realize that the vision isn't mine. It has come to me in a dream. It has come to me from a relative I have never known. But now I am standing before it, my face wet from the spray of water. My eyes are wet with tears of joy. I know what I have to do. I know I will do it. But in doing it, not in a dream, not in the imagination of a child, but in real time before millions of television viewers the world over, I will require 2.5 decades of learning. Those lessons engage the mind, but mostly they engage the spirit. The lessons involve steely determination, yet the source of that determination is God. Without Him, there is no journey, no lesson, no dream. Chapter 2. 2 Feet. Look at that little kid in the backyard of his parents' house in Sarasota, Florida. You won't be impressed by the surroundings. Though his mom and dad are well-known circus performers and part of the legendary Wallenda clan, they live modestly. The scruffy, working-class neighborhood has an almost rural feel. Scattered around the yard is the training gear, the various poles, posts, and bars that aerialists use to hone their skills and develop new stunts. The object that captivates the kid is a cable some 24 inches off the ground strung between two stands. The kid is fixated on the cable. The kid is barely 2 years old. The kid is me. My earliest and strongest memory is stepping out on the wire with the absolute conviction that I would walk across it. I have already seen my parents walk the high wire, an act that seems both wonderful and natural. Naturally, I'm moved to do the same. I take a couple of steps, and then fall. I get back on, only to fall again. I keep getting on and keep falling, getting on and falling, until in a short while, I'm able to walk the entire length of the wire. The accomplishment does not feel remarkable. I don't feel I've done anything extraordinary. It simply feels right. The length of the wire isn't long, just a few yards. I wish it were longer. All that morning and well into afternoon, I keep walking back and forth. I've found my footing. I'm a restless and super energetic child. Yet this short walk over a cable has calmed me down and set me into a state of inexplicable concentration, hardly typical of someone my age. No doubt about it, I've found this magical comfort zone in which time is suspended. "Time to come in," Mom shouts. But I'm not about to come in. I shout back, "I did it. Did you see how good I did it?" "Of course you did it. You did it beautifully. I want to keep doing it." "You need to eat, Nick." "I want to keep doing it." "You will. You have the rest of your life to do it." But would I? All I knew was the joy of a boy who had found the greatest toy in the world. What I didn't know was that my parents were barely making a living. I didn't know that the traditional circus circuit was on the verge of collapse. For all the satisfaction that came with their life as entertainers, they continually faced financial ruin. Circuses were going bankrupt. Premier performers with sterling reputations. Mom and Dad were forced to take all sorts of odd jobs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.